Hello everybody. Today we are going to take up a poem, Sailing to Byzantium by W.B. Yeats. Byzantium actually is the old name for Constantinople or Istanbul. Constantinople or Istanbul was the capital of the eastern part of the Roman Empire. It was a great center of mosaic art and metal enameling. After its conquest by the Turks in 1453, it saw the revival of Greek art and culture known as the Renaissance. Byzantium is a symbol of a country of art and philosophy, which transcends the limits of time and nature, a utopia, a retreat from the process of aging and decaying. Wilson, a critic, also says it is a symbol of the world of intellect and the spirit. Sailing to Byzantium is a poem by W.B. Yeats, taken from the Tower group of poems. Byzantium, as we have seen, is a symbol of a country of art and philosophy that is of eternal relevance for the poet. It is a country full of promises, beauty, peace and happiness. So it is a paradise-like place for him. I'll read out the first stanza for you. That is no country for old men, the young in one another's arms, birds in the trees, those dying generations at their song, the salmon falls, the mackerel crowded seas, fish, flesh or fowl, commend all summer long, whatever is begotten, born and dies. Caught in that sensual music, all neglect, monuments of an aging intellect. So as we see, the poem comprises of four stanzas, each stanza consisting of eight lines with the rhyme scheme AB, AB, CD, EE. That is, they are Ottawa Rima stanzas. The poem Sailing to Byzantium was published in 1927 when Yeats was 62 years of age, and that's why he terms this country not fit enough for old men. So in the first stanza we see that he says the country he's living in is no country for old men. The country here he refers to is a symbolic island or continent of the young. Aterna Nog, the Celtic name for paradise. So there is pun on this Aterna Nog because it is the Celtic name for paradise, and also it is literally, it means the country of the young. So the poet disapproves of his country since it's gone corrupt, he says, degenerate, as young people here in one another's arms are engrossed in sensual physical pleasures. He terms them those dying generations, which also reminds us of Keats's No Hungry Generations Treat Thee Down. So along with these human beings, the birds singing in the trees, the falling salmons in the waterfalls, and the mackerel crowded seas are all romantic scenes implying the sensuousness of his country. fish symbolize all aquatic creatures. Flesh alludes to human beings. Fowl, of course, means all feathery creatures. So fish, flesh and fowl, as he says, whatever is begotten, born and dies, whatever is born in this universe is engrossed in these sensual pleasures and ultimately dies without paying much attention to or without being mindful of art and philosophy, which are monuments of an aging intellect. These are monuments of an aging intellect. These are needed by old people for the pleasure of their souls. So these monuments of an aging intellect are actually intellectual achievements, which are monuments of the intellect and are eternal, ageless, of a permanent value. Immortal works of art and literature, the product of the intellect and the spirit, are contrasted here with the dying generations, the result of sensual gratification. So he wants to leave this country and move on to a place where he would be able to address the works of his intellect, the works of art and literature. The second stanza reads, "An aged man is but a paltry thing, a tattered coat upon a stick, unless soul clap its hands and sing, and louder sing, for every tatter in its mortal dress. Nor is there singing school, but studying monuments of its own magnificence. And therefore I have sailed the seas and come to the holy city of Byzantium." So in this second stanza, the poet metaphorically says that an aged man is neglected like a paltry thing, an insignificant thing. He is as contemptible, as worn out and helpless as a scarecrow, a tattered coat upon a stick. Unless the soul engrosses itself in higher pursuits and dances and sings with joy with every tatter in his mortal dress. That is, his intellectual achievements, they seem to abound as he grows older. The best music, he says, for an aged man is to be engrossed in the immortal works of art and philosophy, produced by the human soul, the unaging intellect. The older one grows, the greater should be his devotion to art and philosophy. Soul clap its hands and sing. This means, or this reminds us of Blake's vision of the soul clapping its hands and dancing. When Blake's brother died, he had a vision of his soul thus moving towards heaven in ecstasy. Therefore, the poet says, these are the reasons he has sailed the seas and come to the holy city of Byzantium, a great center of art and culture, a city given to the spiritual and intellectual activities, and where there are no schools of sensual music. Here in Byzantium, he'll be able to study art and philosophy that are the monuments of its own magnificence, that have their own splendor. The third stanza reads, "O sages, standing in God's holy fire, as in the gold mosaic of a wall. Come from the holy fire, burn in a jaya, and be the singing masters of my soul. Consume my heart away, sick with desire, and fastened to a dying animal. It knows not what it is, and gather me into the artifice of eternity. In this third stanza, the poet invokes the sages standing in God's holy fire, who have thus been purged of the last remnants of sensuality. These sages look like figures represented in the gold mosaic of a wall. The phrase "sages standing in God's holy fire" refers to the statues of martyrs in the frieze at Saint Apollinare Nuoro at Ravenna in Italy, as described by Norman Jeffers. And the phrase "the gold mosaic of a wall" symbolizes art. The poet invokes the sages to descend down in a rapid, whirling, circular, gyrational, spiral, spinning motion, and inspire him and teach him to sing with artistic pleasure, so that all his sensuousness, physical passions and desires may be detached from his soul, leaving it in a pure state. He requests the sages to purify his heart, all sensual pleasure passions, burn them, consume them, so that he can be free from these animal desires that still torture him, though he is grown old and decrepit. The desires are not leaving him, so he seeks the help of these sages. His soul is unable to understand its own reality, its true nature, its purpose in life, so he needs their help, so that his soul is emplaced in Byzantium, the symbol of eternity, and thus give him also the permanence which the great objects of art possess. The works of art and literature are the products of the mind and the spirit, and hence immortal. He wants to enjoy the eternal bliss in the disciplines of art and philosophy. The fourth stanza. Once out of nature, I shall never take my bodily form from any natural thing, but such a form as Grecian goldsmiths make of hammered gold and gold enameling, to keep a drowsy emperor awake, or set upon a golden bough to sing to lords and ladies of Byzantium of what is past or passing or to come. In this fourth stanza, there is a reference to the theory of transmigration of souls, where the soul, after the death of a person, leaves his body and enters a new body. But now that he is in Byzantium, the poet does not want his soul, after it leaves his body, to enter the body of any living creature, but he wants it to take the form of art itself. He wants to be transformed into a golden bird made by the Grecian goldsmiths of hammered gold and gold enameling. This bird is the poet's soul, not subject to death, and in this shape the soul sings celestial songs to lords and ladies of Byzantium in order to infatuate them. In his songs he will sing of the past, the present and the future, that is, he will sing about eternity, eternal times. Yeats has written somewhere, within quotes, "I have read somewhere that in the emperor's palace at Byzantium was a tree made of gold and silver and artificial birds that sing. He is most likely making use of this information in this poem. The last line of the poem reflects the vacillating mood of the poet, and we are uncertain about the fact whether he wants to go for intellectual pursuits or eternity, the transcendental peace, or he wants to return to temporal life. So he seems to be in a confused state of mind, as Daniel Albright also suggests. Within quotes, the poet, fastened to the temporal world, dreams of eternity. The bird, twittering in eternity, sings of time, history. This ending seems to foreshadow a return to nature, perhaps a rebirth of the poet. In one of his other poems, A Dialogue of Self and Soul, Yeats himself rejects nirvana. He chooses rebirth rather than deliverance from birth, that is nirvana. Thank you very much.